together with the team we put together and the new facility we recently moved into in both Florida and Cambridge, we have the resources to get the clinical data on our lead programs, XLRS, achromatopsia B3, the second achromatopsia indication I didn't take the time to talk about, and XLRP. So we have the resources on hand to get four sets of clinical data, which we think positions us very strongly to make good decisions about our next indication and have a rich opportunity to move forward into pivotal trials. So I'm just closing with to remind you of our pipeline and the company highlights, but thank you for your time and attention today.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak here. At Argos, we're developing truly individualized immunotherapies for the treatment of oncology and HIV, and hopefully will be one of our new ARM success stories in the next couple of years, as we're already in phase three. Here are forward-looking statements. So I wanted to start with two emerging fields that are very hot right now. Precision medicine, a lot of initiatives in precision medicine, which is basically looking at biomarkers of individual patients and trying to match therapies with them. We also have the field of immuno-oncology as harnessing the patient's own immune system to fight their disease. At Argos, our approach really is immuno-precision, in that we're looking at those tumor-based samples of the patient, which is their own biomarker, as part of the therapy. So it is an immunotherapy based on that individual tumor expression. The four areas that I wanted to cover today. The first one is Arcellus. It's our key platform, which looks at both autologous tumor and autologous cells as a basis for the therapeutic. The second is our clinical development program. As I mentioned, we're in phase three. We have strong phase two evidence to give us confidence we'll be successful. The commercialization is always the next question, and I'm head of commercial strategy here, and we've been looking at this for over a year, and making this commercially successful, we believe, will be very doable. And lastly, our Arcellus platform goes beyond just our initial indication of metastatic renal cell carcinoma. We believe that if we prove that proof of concept there, that the platform should really be extendable to lung cancer and really any other solid tumor by which we can get a biopsy of that tumor. A key attribute of our philosophy at Argos is the belief that individual mutations are extremely meaningful. What you see here is an example in breast cancer that was reported, where the researchers looked at 50 different tumors, and in those tumors, they found 1,700 mutations. And when you look at the similarity across those tumors, they found that only three of the tumors, only three of the mutations of those 1,700 mutations were common in more than five tumors. So there's extreme heterogeneity in individual tumor mutations, and so this one-size-fits-all approach in the past of cancer therapy, we believe, really has to be varied, and at Argos, we're moving to an extremely precise approach to autologous therapy. So neoantigens, our team, there are two other aspects of the overall approach and the platform that we're building. One is we have to overcome the immune suppression in the tumor microenvironment. A speaker yesterday said that the neoantigens and tumor microenvironment are probably the two biggest aspects of therapy that we need to address. And then lastly, how can you generate a long-lasting memory T-cell tumor-specific response that harnesses the patient's ability to fight their own disease? So this is how we do it. We look at autologous tumor. Our construct is an mRNA construct, so that's how we use the material of the tumor. We take the mRNA, we also synthetically add to it a CD40 ligand, which is a missing signal that I'm going to go into in a moment in cancer. And lastly, we use nature's evolved adaptive immune system, the dendritic cell, to harness its power to process and present to the immune system the key antigens of that patient's tumor. So this is what the situation looks like in an untreated patient. So you have lots of recognition of tumor antigens, so this is protective microenvironment, that the dendritic cells are not getting those signals. Secondly, through the CD40 ligand, CD40 interaction, that signal is also missing in immunosuppressed environments. And so that results in an anergic CD8 response. So the CD8 cytolytic activity, the ability of these cells to proliferate, differentiate, is reduced, and that's where you have the limit growth. So what we do with Arcellus is we harness the patient's own, we harness a biopsy from the patient's tumor. So nephrectomy is standard of care in kidney cancer. We take the tumor cells, we extract the RNA, and load the dendritic cells. So that's what you see in the blue here, is the RNA. That goes into the dendritic cells. The dendritic cells are... How can we simplify this? How can we make it commercially viable? So the nice thing about our therapy is we produce multiple doses of in vial for the patient, multiple doses for intradermal injection based on a single leukapheresis and a single tumor RNA sample. So we're going into MRCC, as I mentioned, in kidney cancer, where there's substantial unmet need. We know that kidney cancer is a tumor response, immunoresponsive tumor. And it's been shown that this is a very reasonable place to go. Right now, the standard of care for RCC is TKI, so oral thymidine kinase inhibitors, VEGF, mTOR, and right now those do have a significant amount of toxicity and limited activity. The worldwide market in kidney cancer is about $2 billion. In the U.S. alone, there are about 20,000 patients, both incident and prevalent patients in MRCC. And unmet need, there's been a lot of talk about value and how you create value and demonstrate value over existing standards. Well, currently in this patient population, those that present within 1 year of treatment, incident patients who get nephrectomy, their survival, overall survival median is 15 months. So we look at case match cohorts of patients with poor risk and intermediate risk, and as I mentioned, that's 15 months. Our phase 2 trial studied 21 patients of intermediate risk and poor risk, and basically as compared to a case match risk match cohort, doubled the survival, OS survival. This was also consistent with PFS and tumor response rate. This is what gave us the confidence to move into our phase 3 trial. Very importantly, whenever you look at an immune modulating agent, especially an individualized immunotherapy like ATS-003, is there a correlation between that immune response you're trying to evoke and the disease parameter, in this case, overall survival? So what you see on the y-axis is overall survival in months. On the x-axis is increasing induced new CD28, CD45 RA negative T cells. That's the phenotype that we believe is extremely important in modulating disease. And so this is the correlation that you see, and this was highly statistically significant after 5 doses of ATS-003 were administered. So our current trial is called the ADAPT trial. It's a phase 3 trial, 2-to-1 randomization, standard of care. In this case, patients are starting with singles. It's randomized in a 2-to-1 fashion. We've enrolled 462 patients. The trial is now fully enrolled. We've had a couple IDMC meetings, we've crossed several thresholds of continuing the trial, and we have another one. Our next milestone is the IDMC meeting in February of next year. Okay, so this has been a subject of a lot of discussion over the past several days at this meeting, the commercial model. We've made a lot of improvements from the prior therapies that have been out there. In particular, this one that we're looking at is Provenge, where with Provenge, every dose had to be preceded by a leukapheresis. As I mentioned before, a single leukapheresis for us yields 16 doses. That enables us to have a centralized manufacturing facility, and it allows us to schedule in a very flexible way for the patients and the clinicians, the half-life of the cooler, of the cryo shipment, going to the clinic in 10 days, so we can very easily schedule that. We've done it in over 100 sites in our phase 3 trial across the U.S. and Europe. Can I go back one? I'll go ahead and thank you. The last bit is probably important as well, is that, you know, one of the issues that plagued the Provenge launch was cost density. So within 6 weeks, the therapy had to be absorbed by the clinical practice. And, ours is a chronic dosing therapy. It's a cryopreserved therapy that really spreads out the cost density over time. So that's what that is a representation of. Moving into our launch with the manual process, we believe will be very cost competitive at cost levels similar to biologics. But we also are thinking ahead and thinking about scale and further cost reductions. And I am extremely proud of our manufacturing and research team with the amount of innovation that they have for the automated process. And so we're